To all my kingdom, the Lord God of heaven has given me the kingdoms of earth, and he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem in Judah, and all his people are now permitted to go to Jerusalem and rebuild the house of the Lord. So all of the heads of the households started to getting their gold and silver and animal and valuable gifts and gathering up all of the goods that wicked King Nebuchadnezzar had stolen from them in the first place when he took them in captivity up to the east into Babylon. Now, this was a remarkable change and turn of events. Actually, remember when Moses brought the people out of Egypt? Well, Ezra, Esther, Nehemiah are kind of seen in the same light as bringing the people of God back to their homeland. God warmed the heart of the king of Babylon, and God prompted the king to give them permission to bring everything back and gave them even some of his own resources to rebuild the table. And so, in terms of dates, 538 BC, the first wave of God's people started to make that 900-mile trek from Babylon to Jerusalem. And for a while, God's big thing became their big thing. Going back to Jerusalem and rebuilding the temple. They rolled up their sleeves as soon as they got back. They got to work and they started rebuilding the temple, which had been totally destroyed during their time of captivity in Babylon. Now, here's another little more context. I said that people returned to Jerusalem in three waves to rebuild the temple. Zerubbabel was the first leader of the first wave in 538 BC. That's told about in Ezra chapters 1 through 6. Zerubbabel. The first wave lasted about 23 years of rebuilding the temple. Ezra led the second wave of the exiles back to rebuild the temple about 60 years later in 458 BC, which is talked about in the second half of the book of Ezra. First half of the book of Ezra, though he was kind of a scribe, kind of a historian, he talks about the people returning in the third person. 7 through the rest of Ezra, he talks about it as himself. So what we're going to focus on today is the first wave going back to rebuild the temple, those first 6 chapters of Ezra, when Zerubbabel led the first wave back. I love that name, Zerubbabel. You know? Anybody have a child that you name Zerubbabel or Zerubbabel Burgess? I wish I would have thought about that years ago. Well, in the first 2 chapters of Ezra, the first wave starts returning, and they were pumped to rebuild the temple. They were all together in one place, and despite their fears of the people around them, they all started rebuilding the temple, working on the foundations and the floor so that they could build the altar on the foundations and start eventually offering sacrifices to God. Dissenters from the outside would sometimes come in and infiltrate them and kind of try to stop their rebuilding of the temple, but they just rutted them right out. And they had the determination and the resolve to build a temple. They made God's big thing their big thing. They made God a priority, and everything was going well. Life was on track. It was good. It was really a good, faithful time for that first wave who came out of Babylon, returned to Jerusalem, and went to work on rebuilding the temple. But then something started to happen. Not right away, but slowly things changed. Little by little, year after year, they lost their passion for the project of rebuilding the temple. They lost their focus. So little by little, they started putting energy into their own projects and needs, and less time and energy and time to rebuild toward the things of God. Maybe they just got tired of all of those stacking of stones, Maybe they grew weary of the constant criticism from the outsiders, but most likely they started getting sidetracked by things they needed to do. Their personal business, their farms, their homes, their kids, all of them started to demand more and more attention, so they started spending more time at home and less time rebuilding the temple. At first, they went back and they worked 6.5 days a week. I mean, they took off an evening to watch Monday Night Football, but they didn't mind, you know, the calloused hands and strained back. But after a couple of months, it was maybe 5 days a week, and then it was 4 days a week, and then it was just Sunday afternoon every once in a while. And after about 10 years, nobody was working on the temple. Nobody was working on the temple. And for 16 years, the temple lay untouched. Imagine not mowing your lawn for 16 years. Weeds and grass started to grow up around the base of the temple. Wooden platforms started weathering in the sun. Soon it looked like sometimes you drive by a building project that had started and then it just got quit and abandoned. Soon other nations started looking at the abandoned temple and thinking they don't care about God. 16 years, soon kids that were born started looking at the way their parents spent their time, not even working on a temple, not worshiping, not nothing, and think, well, my parents don't care about God, why should I? It was a long 16 years of laying fallow, abandoned, and nothing was happening. Soon the children started drifting away and people started realizing that God's big thing had become their little thing. Their little thing. And while God's house was languishing, their own homes were flourishing. They were spending lots of time remodeling their homes, changing out the old olive green kitchen into more modern macadamia color. They were getting fenced-in hot tubs. They were getting house cleaners and lawnmowers. In their own homes, things were going well. But in God's house, things were falling apart. After 16 years of being abandoned and grown over with weeds. Now, Haggai, to throw in a little note here, Haggai was also a prophet during this time. And we're not touching on Haggai except for the words that Haggai says. Haggai says, "Is this a time for you to be living in paneled houses while God's house remains in a ruin? You've planted much but harvested little. You eat but never have enough. You drink but never have you filled. You put on clothes but you're never worn. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it." That's what Haggai said. Ouch. That hit home to them. They had gotten distracted. And they put God's big thing on their little back burner for 16 years. That's what happens when we get distracted. You know, that's what happens when God's big thing becomes our little thing. Have you ever had a time in life when you were so excited about God and faith and following and fizzy and all of that, and you just started falling away? It just started falling away. But God says through Haggai, think about what you're doing. Think about what you're doing. Be careful about your ways. Haggai says to him, go up to the mountain and bring down timber and build a house so that God may be take pleasure in it and be honored. But God also, God wanted their thing to be their, God wanted his big thing to be their big thing. And God was a little ticked off, which God sometimes gets in the Old Testament. And God added consequences because of their spiritual lethargy and misplaced priorities. And God says, I'm going to bring drought on your fields, on the grain, on everything that the ground produces, on the people and the livestock, and on the labor of their hands. God sent consequences for their unfaithfulness because they ignored their work on the temple, which sent messages to those in town and their children that they didn't even believe in God anymore, and they didn't even certainly care about God's house. Of course, they didn't mean to do that. They didn't mean to do that. But over time, gradually, they gave their attention elsewhere and neglected and started to ignore God. They just slip slide it away. Now, you know, I have yet to meet a person who just one day deliberately decided to set out and ignore God, but I've seen all kinds of people drift away from God. Drift away because they allowed something else. Important things, kids, jobs, demands of life, stress, struggles, whatever it is, getting away. The drift started slowly, one day at a time, and soon they woke up and had not even thought about God's priorities any longer. It's not that one day they just decided, I'm going to forget about God, but it was just rather slowly, over time, drifting into a place where they didn't think about God anymore. That's what happened to the people when they returned from captivity in Babylon to rebuild the temple. They came back all pumped up, ready to go, and everybody had their part, everyone was participating, and everybody was honoring God, but slowly and slowly they got distracted and drifted away. And that didn't please God, because all through the Old Testament we've seen so far, God isn't interested in leftovers. God isn't interested in lackadaisical, lazy kinds of Christians. God is interested in people who wake up and say, "Good morning, Lord," rather than, "Good Lord, it's morning." God would much rather have you begin your day saying, "God, today I want to get to know you and love you even better. And if the day ends and I know more of your love, then this day will be one of significance." You might have all kinds of success during the day, but if you don't get to know God more in your daily walk, then your day might have been successful, but it will not have been significant. Because the goal in life is to align our lower story with God's upper story and love God and love one another. That's why God really does not want you to drift. God wants God's big thing to be your big thing, not a little thing. That's why Paul writes in Colossians 3, "Dudes, whatever you do, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him." He writes in Romans, "Present yourself as an instrument of God's righteousness." He says, whatever you do, follow Jesus. Wouldn't you want to be an instrument of God's righteousness? Wouldn't that be cool? Giving your whole life to God and writing the name of Jesus over your whole life is a way to keep that faith alive in God's big thing, your big thing. Today is the first Sunday in Lent, and what a better time to do that. I mean, Christians around the world are giving up something for Lent. And, you know, sometimes I think that can be a good thing. And OpenBible.com did a big survey in the weeks before February 15th, Ash Wednesday this year. They looked at 102,000 tweets and ranked them in this picture, ranking with what people are giving up with bigger letters, about 100 things. Kyle, could you put that up there? These are the top 100 things people tweeted that they're giving up during Lent just this year. Look at all the things they came up with. Most people are giving up chocolate. Some are giving up Twitter, school, swearing, social networking, alcohol. You can see right under chocolate, some people are giving up Lent for Lent. Great. You know, you might find something you're giving up during Lent on there. And I think that's great. If it's something that brings you closer to God, then I'm all for it. If giving up something like junk food or soda brings you closer to God and causes you not to drift, great, go for it. But you know, I tend to think it's more important to remember that the Lord God Almighty, who created the stars in the heavens, did you look at the stars last night? I mean, they were so awesome, who put the planets in their place, who causes the sun to rise and the moon to beam, the God who created the glittering mountains and the foaming and roaring sea, the God who made the wildflowers and the grass to grow and gives beauty to that relationship, that God wants a relationship with you that's real and personal. That God wants his big thing to be your big thing. God just doesn't want this small little pie chart portion of your life, but wants you to write the name of Jesus over everything so that you can do everything in the name of the Lord God, giving thanks to God the Father through him. God doesn't want just leftovers from last Tuesday or appetizers. God wants to be the meat and potatoes of your life. You know, C.S. Lewis once wrote that if you put first things first, you get the second and third things thrown in. But if you do the second and third things first, then you lose both the first, the second, and the third. Like the revelation of John, "But this I have against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then from where you have fallen, repeat, and do the works that you did at first." Do the first things first. God's people who returned from Babylon put the second, third, and fourth things first in their lives, and they lost the first thing. Today we can learn from their mistakes and put first things first, knowing Jesus, following him, serving him in all that we do. Let's close in prayer.